Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for coming to Praxis's lecture tonight. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Stephen E. Landsburg, who is a professor of economics at the University of Rochester, where students recently elected him Professor of the Year. He is the author of The Armchair Economist, Fair Play, More Sex is Safer Sex, The Big Questions, two textbooks in economics, a forthcoming textbook on general relativity and cosmology, and over 30 journal articles in mathematics, economics, and philosophy. His current research is in the area of quantum game theory. He writes the monthly Everyday Economics column in Slate magazine and has written regularly for Forbes and occasionally for the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and the Washington Post. He appeared as a commentator on the PBS Turner Broadcasting series Damn Right and has made over 200 appearances on radio and television broadcasts over the past few years. We are excited to welcome him here to Hillsdale.
We're going to talk about whether the world has too many people. Does the world have too many people? Let's start with an easier question. Does the world have too much pollution? You might think that's a really easy question, because pollution is obviously a bad thing. We don't like it. But that doesn't necessarily mean that we have too much of it. After all, a world with zero pollution is not the world that any one of us wants to live in. A world with zero pollution would be a world with no central heating, no modern transportation, no way for me to get to Hillsdale. We want to put up with a certain amount of pollution. And once you agree that the right amount of pollution is not zero, you are then faced with the question of what is the right amount. As soon as you agree that we want to have some pollution, it becomes a little less clear whether the world has too much or too little. Now, I'm pretty sure I know the answer to that. I'm pretty sure the world has too much pollution. And the reason for that is that the people who decide to pollute, the people who decide to drive their cars and do the other things that cause pollution, are often not taking account of the effects that their decisions have on other people. And when people make choices that impose costs on other people, they tend to not care so much about those costs, and they tend to engage in too much of those activities. By the same token, when people do things that have benefits for other people, like they go out and they pick up trash off the quad, they tend to do too little of that stuff. You don't see very many people out there doing that, and the reason for that is that the benefits accrue to people other than themselves. So when people make choices that affect only themselves, they tend to get things right. When they make choices that affect other people too, they sometimes get things wrong. Okay? If we want to think about whether the world has too many or too few people, or for that matter, if we want to think about whether the world has too much or too little of anything, we have to think about the benefits and the costs of that thing, the benefits and costs of pollution, the benefits and costs of bringing more people into the world, the benefits and costs of whatever it is that you're talking about. But we don't have to worry about all of the benefits and costs, because the benefits and the costs that accrue to the decision maker is already taking account of those. If you were deciding how many children to have, and the only person affected by your choices was you, then I would expect you to do a better job than anybody else of getting that number right. You would weigh the benefits and costs of having another child. You would decide whether you want to have that child or not. And there's no reason anybody should second guess you. If you were the only person who was affected by your polluting activities, you would get the amount of pollution right. You would pick the right amount. You would account for the good and the bad, and again, there'd be no reason for anybody to second guess you. So if we want to think about benefits and costs, be it population or anything else, we want to divide things a little more finely. Not just benefits and costs, but we want to divide between what I'll call the private benefits and costs, the ones that are felt by the decision makers, and the spillover benefits and costs, the ones that affect other people. Those are the ones that an economist would call externalities, but I didn't want to use a fancy word like that in a room where we might not have all economics majors, so I called them spillovers. It means the same thing. People, benefits and costs that are felt by somebody other than decision makers. The point is that the stuff that goes in the private column, we don't have to worry about because the decision maker's worrying about that for us. It's the stuff that goes in the spillover column we have to worry about. Nevertheless, let's start by thinking about what goes in that private column. What are some of the private benefits of having a child? Private means that it accrues to the decision maker, that the person who decided to have that child is going to enjoy that benefit. The big one, of course, is love. We have children because we expect to love them. We expect them to love us, except for a few years there in the teenage years, they usually do. That's a huge one, right? That's the main reason, at least in the modern world, why people have children. On the cost side, if you have another child, you're going to have to feed that child. You're going to have to clothe that child. In the early years, you're going to be up late nights taking care of that child when the child is sick. In later years, you're going to be bailing them out of jail. Those are all costs that you're going to weigh against those benefits when you're deciding how many kids to have. Again, if that were the whole story, there would not be any problem. There would not be such a thing as a population problem. There would not be such a thing. Everybody would decide what size family they want to have, and we could all make different choices and celebrate diversity. If you want to think about the population problem, or if you think it might be a problem, it all comes down to the spillover. Because, you know, when people talk about overpopulation or underpopulation or the right population, a lot of times they start off by saying, well, obviously there's a limit to the number of people the world can support. Anybody who starts the conversation like that, I guarantee you, anybody who starts the conversation by pointing out that there's a limit to the number of people the world can support is a person who has never thought seriously about this problem. Because we all know that there is such a thing as too many people. That's all they're telling you, is there's such a thing as too many people. We all know that. There's also such a thing as too few people. We know that too. Okay? None of us would want to be the only person in the world. Okay? So we all know there's such a thing as too many. We all know there's such a thing as too few. Pointing that out does nothing to help us understand whether we currently have too many or too few people. The only way to address that, and this is a moral that goes beyond population, the only way to address the question of whether you've got too much or too little of something is to look at benefits and costs, and specifically to concentrate on those spillover benefits and costs. So let's go to the spillover benefits of having a child. One is the children that you have, typically, you're not the only person who's going to love those children over the course of their lives. And your parents, and I know it doesn't always seem this way when you're 18 years old, but probably there's going to come a point in your life when somebody other than your parents is going to love you. Those people who love you, those people who enjoy having you around, are receiving benefits from your parents' decision to have a child. Those are benefits that your parents probably didn't account for. When the parents were saying, do we want to have this kid or not, they were thinking about how the kid's going to affect them. They weren't thinking so much about how it was going to affect other people. But there was going to be this positive effect on other people. Okay? Other people love us, other people are glad we're there. In the same category, friendship. Everybody who considers you a friend is glad you're here. And again, that's a benefit to the world that your parents might not have fully accounted for when they decided to have you. Another thing that each new child brings to the world is a little more diversity. A little more, and diversity is good not just because it exposes us to other things that we might like, but because it makes it possible for us to accumulate critical masses of people who have obscure interests. The reason we can have chamber music is because we have a pretty big population. Okay? You need a critical mass of people who like chamber music before you can have chamber music. Most people don't listen to chamber music. So you need a pretty big population before you get enough of them to support that. We need a pretty big population before we can have Ethiopian restaurants, which is why there are a lot more Ethiopian restaurants in New York than there are in Hillsdale. Those are benefits of for goodness sake, the fact that a place like Hillsdale can exist relies on having a critical mass of people. which if there were half as many people, half as many interested in coming to Hillsdale, you might not have Hillsdale. The other one though, and the big one, so I put it in a different font because it's big, is that every child born into this world is at some point or another going to have some ideas, and other people generally benefit from your ideas, not just because you implement those ideas yourself, but because we all watch each other's ideas and we copy from them. And that's huge. And when I say ideas, I mean big ideas and little ideas. Ideas like, hey, I wonder if we could make computer chips out of silicon. And ideas like, hey, let's put on a play, okay? All of those ideas are things that other people get to observe, they get to see how they work out, and they copy those ideas and they improve on them. And the more people there are, the more of those ideas there are going to be. So I'm not done with my chart here yet. We still have to talk about what goes in the spillover cost box, and that's important too. But before I go on to that, I want to say a bit more about how very important those ideas are that people have, and how much we all benefit from having more people in the world who will have more ideas. For that, let's digress into a brief history of the human race. Modern humans have been around for about 100,000 years. 100,000 years ago, these people emerged. Then, for the next 99,800 years, nothing happened. Oh, there were some wars, there was some political intrigue, there was the invention of agriculture, there was the Renaissance. None of that mattered, okay? None of that mattered in the sense that from the dawn of mankind up until just about 200 years ago, the time of the Industrial Revolution, 99,800 years, the black part of that timeline, virtually everyone who ever lived right at the subsistence level, on the verge of starvation, on the modern equivalent of about $400, $500, maybe $600 a year. There were a few times and a few places where things were substantially better than that for a while, even some extremely fortunate times and places where it might have been as much as twice as good, the equivalent of $1,000 a year. No place where it was better than that. There were a small number of very wealthy people, kings and queens and dukes and princes, who lived much better, but they were numerically insignificant. So if you were born at any time before that little red part of the timeline there, the odds are astronomical that you would have lived on the modern equivalent of $400, $500, $600 a year, just like your parents, just like your grandparents, just like your children, just like your grandchildren. Then, for reasons not yet fully understood, somewhere around the year 1800, at least in the West, incomes started to rise. In 1800, they were rising by about 0.75% a year. By 1820, a couple decades later, this was spreading around the world, and in the West, the growth rate was up to 1.5% a year. It's grown ever since. Since 1960, in the United States at least, we've averaged growth of about 2.3% a year. That's per person after correcting for inflation. Incomes have grown about 2.3% a year per person since correcting for inflation. Well, that's a very abstract number. Let's think concretely about what it means. Let's suppose that you are a working class, middle class American with a modest income of, let's say, about $50,000 a year, a family income of $50,000 a year. That's pretty modest by today's standards. If that 2.3% growth rate continues for the next 25 years, then your children, assuming they occupy that same middling rung on the economic ladder, will be making the inflation-adjusted equivalent of $89,000 a year. That's not some future inflation-ravaged dollars. That's $89,000 of today's dollars. Just extrapolating out that 2.3% growth rate. 25 years after that, your grandchildren will be making $158,000 a year. From $50,000 a year to 89,000 a year to 158,000 a year in two generations. That's the power of economic growth. And if you extrapolate that out, say another 400 years, again, assuming that still 2.3% growth rate, which is a conservative assumption, because growth rates, in fact, have done nothing but increase since they started 200 years ago. Now I'm assuming it's going to level off at 2.3%. With that conservative assumption, your descendants, your descendants 400 years from now will be making the inflation-adjusted equivalent of $1 million per day, unless they rise above mediocrity and live even better. You might find that wildly implausible. If you do, I invite you to imagine that you were sitting there 400 years ago and I was explaining to you what today's world was going to be like. You would have found it equally implausible. You would have found it more implausible. Okay? In fact, nobody ever believes that things are going to get better at the rate that they are. Here is, I've got 100 different quotes I could have given you. Here's Julius Frontinus in the year 100 AD. Inventions have long since reached their limit. I see no hope for future development. People have said that in every era of human history. But again, if things continue just at the same rate they've been going for the last 50 years, in 400 years, your descendants are going to be making $1 million a day. I don't know that's going to happen. I don't know that the Earth is going to survive for another 400 years. But it is a conservative estimate. Here is what per capita income in the United States looks like over history. That's per capita income. It's in fixed dollars. So again, everything is corrected for inflation. You can see what's happened since, again, about the time of the Industrial Revolution there. It looks pretty dramatic. The United States is not a particularly fast-growing country. We are richer than most countries. We are richer than most countries first because we started growing sooner than most countries did. They got later starts. And second, because a lot of other countries have had disasters where some, often where some extremely corrupt government has come in and put a halt to this kind of growth. But averaged over all countries, this is pretty medium level growth. That's what economic growth looks like. That little jag down at the top there is the recession we've just come through. In the 1930s, you'll see another more dramatic jag down. That's what's called the Great Depression, which you might have heard about from your grandparents or great-grandparents. Here's what happened in the Great Depression. Incomes fell back to where they had been 25 years earlier. And people found it unthinkable, intolerable. Okay? It was horrible to have to live the way their parents had lived. It was intolerable to have to live the way their parents had lived. That underlying expectation, the expectation that things are supposed to get better, those people took it for granted, and we take it for granted today. We assume that every year our cars and our electronic equipment are going to be better than they were the year before. That's new. That's new in history. Before the year 1800, nobody ever expected things to get better because things never had gotten better. No 19th century politician ever asked, "Are you better off than you were 4 years ago?" Because nobody in the 19th century ever expected to be better off than they were 4 years ago. Now, if we're not better off than we were 4 years ago, we throw the bums out, right? It's not just incomes that have improved. It's also our leisure time. 100 years ago, the average work week was 65 hours. Today it's about 33. 100 years ago, 6% of workers ever took vacations. Today it's effectively 100%. 100 years ago, 26% of 65-year-old men were retired. Today, 90% of 65-year-old men are retired. And 100 years ago, most people didn't make it to 65. So the 65-year-olds were really old. They were really old, and 3/4 of them were still working. Today, the 65-year-olds are, I hope, much younger, and only 10% of them are working. Child labor was common in 1910. 14-year-olds entered the workforce routinely. Now we have effectively no child labor in this country. And let me digress, since I've digressed from the population problem into this economic growth business, let me digress from that for a minute into saying a few more words about child labor. A lot of people will tell you, when they talk about child labor in the third world, they'll try to tell you that it's being caused by multinational corporations that are somehow tricking people into sending their children into the workforce. Here's why that can't be right. Because in 1840, when the United States and England were about as poor as those places in the third world are right now, we were sending our children to work at about the same rate that they're sending their children to work at right now. And we were doing it at a time when there was no such thing as a multinational corporation. What history tells us is that sending your children to work is a natural response to a certain level of poverty. When you're really poor, you have to make horrible choices. One of those horrible choices is, do I send my kid to a terrible job, or do I send that same kid to bed hungry? It's a terrible choice, and what we've learned is that when people are at a certain level of poverty, they choose to send the kids to work. When they get a little richer, they pull those kids out of the workforce. That happened around 1840 in the West, and it's happening, interestingly, in Asia and Africa as people hit those same income levels at which Westerners pulled their kids out of the workforce. That's where they're pulling their kids out of the workforce. It's history repeating itself. What's the cure for child labor? The cure for child labor is higher incomes. That's what higher incomes have done for us. Because of higher incomes, we work fewer hours per week. We work, because of the vacations, fewer weeks per year. Because of the retirement, we work fewer years per lifetime. And because of the child labor, we work fewer years per lifetime at the other end. Another difference, in 1910, the average housekeeper spent 12 hours a day on cooking, laundry, cleaning. By 2010, that was 1.5 hours. Here's the typical laundry day in the year 1900. Our heroine ports these enormous buckets of water to the stove where she heats them up. She takes the clothes, she puts them in there, she washes the clothes out in the vats. She wrings them out by hand, which is a grueling thing if you think about it, from one article of clothing after another. She wrings them out by hand, hangs them up, and then goes on to the worst part of the job of all, which is ironing using these gigantic heavy flat irons, which are heated continuously over the stove and extremely hot. In the process, to do one load of laundry, she works for 8.5 hours and she walks over a mile. We know this because the United States government used to hire people, they hired researchers, to follow housewives around and count every step they took as they did their jobs. And from those reports, we know that in 1900, an average laundry day took 8.5 hours and a mile of walking. By 1940, she's got a washing machine. Now she's working 2.5 hours and she's walking 665 feet. Okay. Today, I throw my laundry in the washing machine, I forget about it, and it texts me to let me know when it's done. So there's what's happened to laundry. Other routine household tasks. In 1900, most houses had no central heating. Most houses had no running water. So routine household tasks included lugging 7 tons of coal and 9,000 gallons of water around the house every year. All of that is gone. Even just since 1965, the last 50 years, just since 1965, the average American worker has gained 6 hours a week of leisure, is working 6 hours a week less than 50 years ago. 6 extra hours a week, multiply that out, that's the equivalent of 7 extra vacation weeks a year. So our incomes are higher, we're working a whole lot less, and on top of that, the quality of the goods that we buy has increased dramatically. If you don't believe me, get yourself a 40-year-old Sears catalog leaf through it and ask yourself if there's anything in there you would be willing to buy. Okay? I guarantee it's an eye-opening experience. Here's a random selection almost from that catalog. 50 years ago, you could buy an AM radio with separate tone control. It only gets AM. I wish I could reproduce for you what the speaker quality was on those things. Or you could buy this camera here, which weighed 3 pounds. It took, with a roll of film and a thing of flash bulbs, you could take 8 pictures. And then after you took your 8 pictures, you had to replace the film, replace the flash bulbs, all of which was an extremely expensive process. Those flash bulbs went off about 2/3 of the time. The other third, you didn't get your picture. And I know you're looking at the prices there, but don't forget, we need to correct those prices for inflation if you really want to see what those things cost. $128 for the radio, $210 for the camera. Think about the difference between that and what you can buy today for that kind of money. Or take a product like healthcare. There's all kinds of things wrong with our healthcare system. But despite that, the quality of healthcare is growing and has grown so rapidly that I just learned this from Michael Kramer, who's a professor at Harvard. If you look at healthcare outcomes in the third world today, the poorest parts of the third world today, and if you measure the quality of those outcomes by life expectancy, by infant mortality, or by any of the other standard measures that are used to measure healthcare outcomes, the poorest parts of the third world today, and if you correct for the existence of AIDS, if you pretend that we didn't have AIDS, which you might argue is a reasonable or an unreasonable thing to do, but the argument for it being reasonable is you could say that AIDS is sort of a one-time thing that does not speak to trends in healthcare. It speaks to a one-time disaster that does not tell us much about trends, and therefore we should take it out. You could argue the other way too. But if you take it out, then the outcomes we're getting in the very poorest parts of the third world today are exactly the same as what we were getting in the United States in 1970, 45 years ago. That's how fast our healthcare has gotten better. And if you think that healthcare has not improved, I think the right measure is this. If you think healthcare now has gotten more expensive per outcome, ask yourself whether you would rather have today's healthcare at today's prices or that 1970s healthcare at 1970 prices. I venture to guess that any well-informed person would take today's healthcare at today's prices, which has to mean that despite all the concern about rising costs, and a lot of it is justified, despite all of that, healthcare today is a better bargain than it's ever been. So the moral of that is that, again, incomes are up, leisure is up, quality of goods is up. Henry VIII ruled all of England, but that does not stop the average middle class of American from living a far more luxurious life than he ever could have possibly imagined. And I'm willing to bet he would have given up half his kingdom for modern plumbing, a lifetime supply of antibiotics, and access to the internet.
And anesthesia.
So we've got all that prosperity. Where does all that prosperity come from? It comes from ideas. In fact, I recently spoke to a historian who told me that the reason the Industrial Revolution happened when it did is that it all comes down to the spread of one mega idea, one idea that took hold and spread around Europe. And that was the idea, which people somehow hadn't had before, that no matter what it is you do all week, it's worth, once a week or so, taking off a couple of hours to figure out how to do it better. And once that idea caught on and spread, then people started having ideas, copying those ideas, and that's why economic growth, That's why it was first 3/4% and then 1.5% and then 2.3%, because the more ideas you have, the more there are to copy and the easier it becomes to come up with new and better ideas. Where do those ideas come from? They come from people. And then to complete that virtuous circle, more people means more ideas means more prosperity, and more prosperity means we can support more people. Michael Kramer, the same economist at Harvard I quoted before, has a paper where he traces the history of economic growth from the very beginnings of mankind. I said 100,000 years ago. He dates it from 1,000,000 years ago because there are questions about, you know, at what point do you start calling things people? So he goes back. He has a more liberal definition of what's human than I do. He goes back 1,000,000 years and discovers that what we see over and over is this virtuous circle. Unfortunately, in some times and in some places, it gets broken for one reason or another. But you see this pattern over and over around the world. When you have more people, you have more ideas. When you have more ideas, you have more prosperity. When you have more prosperity, you have more people. So here's a good economist. Some of you might recognize him. That's Ted Baxter. He was the buffoonish anchorman on the old Mary Tyler Moore show, which you might have seen on Nick at Night. Ted was sort of portrayed as a clown on that show. Again, he was a news anchorman. On one episode, Ted said that he was planning to have 6 children because he was hoping that one of them would figure out the solution to the world's population problem. He was a lousy anchorman, but he was a good economist. That's exactly the right idea. People have ideas. The more ideas there are, the more problems get solved. And when I talk about ideas, you know, I've pointed to all these great technological marvels, these electronics, cars, things like that. But it's not just engineers who come up with good ideas. It's also the farmer who comes up with a new method of crop rotation, or the business person who comes up with a new method of inventory management. Those things are huge. Walmart invented just-in-time inventory management. Other places copied it. Nothing has done more to improve the quality of life for poor Americans than just-in-time inventory management, what that's done to retail prices. And ideas matter not just on their own, but because of the way they interact with each other. The reason you can fly from Detroit to Tokyo is partly because somebody figured out how to build an airplane, partly because somebody else figured out how to insure it. The reason you've got a personal computer on your desk is partly because somebody figured out that we can make computer chips out of silicon, partly because somebody else figured out that we can finance startup companies with junk bonds. And if you want to know which of those contributions was more important, a good rough measure is to follow the money. By that measure, if we think about these computers, in the early days of personal computers in the 1980s, when we were all starting to get them on our desks, Microsoft had annual profits of about $600 million. $600 million was also the annual income of Michael Milken, the man who invented junk bonds. So by that measure, the two contributions looked like they were of about equal value. So all of that is meant to emphasize the importance of ideas, the importance of having more people to give us more ideas. So important that I'm going to put it in an even bigger font. So that addresses my upper right corner there. We still have to talk about the lower right corner, the spillover costs of having children, the bad stuff that you do to other people when you increase the size of your family. The first one everybody thinks about is resource consumption. Each new child eats fish, burns fuel, takes up space, which is not available for other people. What we still have to decide, though, is does that resource consumption count as a spillover cost or a private cost? Well, it depends on where you get those resources that you consume. Where do you get those? If I eat an apple, Maybe I grew that apple myself and nobody else would have grown it otherwise. In that case, I'm not taking that apple from anyone else, right? That's not a spillover on anyone else. Or maybe I traded for that apple. I grew a pear and I traded the pear for the apple. Again, that's not imposing a cost on anyone else. The other place that we get a lot of resources, we create things, we trade for things. The other place where a lot of us, and I suspect a lot of people in this room, get a lot of their resources is we get them from our parents. We get them financially when we live with them. We get them financially when they die. And it's not just the financial stuff, it's everything else too. It's all the education, all the training, all the values they instilled in us, everything they taught us about the world. All of that goes into our ability to consume resources, to earn income and consume resources. And where does that stuff come from? Who bears the cost of that? Mostly it's your siblings, because whatever you get, they're not getting. If you have an older brother, the day you were born was the worst day of that older brother's life. You cut the inheritance in half, you cut the parental attention in half, you cut the financial contributions while you were living at home in half. And here's the thing, here's the important thing. Your parents, in most cases, loved that older brother, knew what they were doing to him, and still thought you were worth it. Which means the decision maker took account of the cost. It's just like if you were polluting and having to breathe that pollution yourself, then I would know that that pollution is worthwhile pollution. If you're choosing to have the pollution, even though you're the one who breathes it, then I know that that's good pollution, that that's pollution that's worth the cost. If you bring a child into this world and divert a lot of resources to that child and take them away from another child you love, I know that child, that second child, was worth the cost, because otherwise you wouldn't have done that. So those resources, the ones you get from your parents, and that's a lot, they don't go in the spillover column. They go in the cost column. They go in the private column. Or to say that another way, a lot of people seem to have the idea that if I weren't here, there would be a little more of everything. They see me eating, they see me taking up space, they see me driving my car. And they say, if he weren't here, there'd be a little more for everybody else. It's not true. If I weren't here, there'd be a lot more for those two people, my sisters. But no more for any of you. Okay? They would have all gotten it instead of me. And again, as long as my parents cared about my sisters and made that choice, that means that the cost of my resource consumption was accounted for and can't count as a negative in our cost-benefit analysis. Now, that's not to say that all of my resource consumption goes in that category. We're asking which of these boxes it goes in. There are other sorts of resource consumption too. I'm gonna put some of it on the left, but there's also, some people get resources through thievery or by making war on people, or by activities that involve major pollution. Those things impose, if I steal from you, then yes, you would have been better off if I hadn't been born. If I make war on you, you would have been better off if I hadn't been born. So those are spillover costs. Those are the things we have to weigh against the spillover benefits if we want to know whether the world has too many or too few people. We want to know whether the spillover cost of an extra child is more or less than the spillover benefit, and those are the sorts of things we have to compare. Another thing you might want to put in that spillover column is public assistance. If you go on public assistance, then you're imposing costs on other people, and arguably that also goes in the spillover column. I say arguably because I've heard people argue against it, but I think it actually belongs there. The whole question, if you want to know whether the world is overpopulated, you got to compare those two boxes on the right, ignore the boxes on the left, we know that got accounted for, look at the boxes on the right and ask which one is bigger. I don't know which one is bigger. I have a strong suspicion that the benefit side is bigger. I have a strong suspicion the benefit side is bigger because ideas are so huge. I have a strong suspicion it's bigger because ideas make such a difference to the quality of the world we live in. And also because most people actually don't become major thieves or warriors. And I'm not counting that notebook you shoplifted in seventh grade. Most of you probably are not significant thieves. Here's maybe a more graphical way of making the point. These are plots of land belonging to two different families. The family on the right, they practice zero population growth. Every generation is the same size as the previous generation. And every generation has a plot of land the same size. The family on the left, they double every generation. So a generation from now, everybody in that family's got half as much land, and then half as much, and then half as much, and then half as much. And a few generations down the line, the people on the right are rich, and the people on the left are poor. Does that mean anybody made a mistake? No, it means that these people have got the benefits of being rich, and these people have got the benefits of having a lot of grandchildren. And different people make different choices, and that's okay. As long as those choices don't impinge on each other, there's no social issue there. It's okay to have a bunch of children, even if it makes you poor, provided that's what you want to do. The social problem, if there is any, arises only if these families somehow interact. So that if the family on the left gets tired of being poor and decides to make war on the family on the right, that's a problem. And the family on the right might say, gee, I wish they hadn't had so many kids. But at the same time, if the family on the left provides a lot more potential friends for these guys on the right, a lot more potential mates, a lot more diversity, and above all, a lot more ideas that the people on the right can copy, that's a reason why the people on the right might say, boy, we're glad they had so many kids. We wish they'd had even more. Maybe we should subsidize them for it. If we all cared about strangers as much as we cared about ourselves, this would not be a problem. If I cared about all of you as much as I care about my own family, then I would have accounted for you when I decided how many kids to have. Okay? And I would have made the right choices. I might have made some mistakes, but I at least would have, you know, in expectation, have made the right choices. Unfortunately, that's not true. I was selfish. I only have one child. I have one child because we thought about it. We compared the benefits to ourselves and the cost to ourselves. We didn't think about the rest of the world. And we said, yeah, one seems about right. So that's my child. She's a girl. The point is that somewhere, maybe in this room, there is a young woman about the age of my daughter whose life is permanently impoverished by the fact that I did not have the son who would have someday swept her off her feet. And if I had cared about that woman as much as I care about my daughter, I would have had that son. But because I did not, I never even knew who she was, because I didn't care about that woman, that's why we stopped at one child. I just threw that one in to prove we're related. On these subjects, the last thing I want to mention is because whenever you talk about population, somebody tries to talk about overcrowding and how crowded the world is. Okay, and this especially comes up in the East where I'm from, because in the East where I'm from, everybody thinks the world looks like that. But that's not what the world looks like, okay? And you guys have a much clearer perspective on this. Most of the world looks like that. There is a lot of room in the world, okay? There is an incredible amount of space in the world. That's the Grand Canyon. What fraction of the world's population do you think can fit in the Grand Canyon if you stack them around? What fraction of the world's population do you think I can fit in there? The entire world population 500 times over. You can fit 500 times the world's population in there.
Shoulder to shoulder.
Yeah, like I said, you stack them right. Or if that's a little too gruesome an image for you, here's a different image, which I got from Tom Sowell. Take the state of Texas, divide it into lots which are the size of the average middle class house lot in the United States. Divide it into lots which are the size of the average middle class house lot in the United States. On each of those lots, put a family of four, and you've just housed the entire Woods population. Now, admittedly, you would still need Oklahoma for all the fast food places, but you're fitting the entire world in a very small place. Why then do people live in Calcutta and New York? The answer is the only possible reason that people live in crowded places is because a lot of people like to live in crowded places. Not everybody does. And the ones who don't have to. They can live in Hillsdale. They can live in Cedar Rapids. They can live anywhere they want. Okay? People in New York complain about the crowds all the time, but you don't see them moving to Coldwater, Minnesota. Okay? Why not? You ask them why they're not moving. Well, because they got the theater, and they got the symphony, and they've got the bookstores, and yeah, and why do they have that? They have that because there are crowds. Without the crowds, you can't have that. Okay? A lot of people like to live where there are crowds. In India, people are moving from the unpopulated rural areas to places like Calcutta, not the other way around. The few who prefer to stay in the rural areas, nobody's stopping them. Nobody's stopping them. There's plenty of room. And yet still, people have this idea that the world is overcrowded. And I think the reason for that, psychologically, is that when you're stuck in traffic on a hot summer night, it's really easy to remember that life would be better if that guy in front of you weren't there. It's really hard to remember somehow that life would be so much worse if the guy who invented a car air conditioning hadn't been there. And if you cut the world's population, you're as likely to cut him as to cut that driver in front of you. So I come back to my chart, and I come back to my main idea, and again, I want to stress that my real message here goes far beyond population. Whenever you want to know if the world has too much or too little of something, you want to enumerate the spillover benefits and the spillover costs and ask which is bigger. This is an illustration of a problem to which you can apply that, and on this problem, my strong guess is that the benefit side is much bigger. I can't prove that, and I'll stop there. And I'm happy to stay for questions as long as anybody wants to stay. Or if I've answered all your questions, that's fine. Yeah.
So Julian Simon, who's famous for doing, looking at resource prices, and of course the one price that he said, the one resource where the price seems to keep going up is the price of labor. That is the real wage rate seems to go up through history.
Right.
So how does that get at your idea that doesn't that capture at least some of the ideas right there?
Yeah, I mean, the reason real wage rates go up is because workers become more productive, and the reason workers become more productive is because of ideas, because of advances in technology. So the increase in wage rates, which has we've seen all through history, comes from two things. It comes from the accumulation of capital, and it comes from technological advances, and there are limits to what you can get from the accumulation of capital, because if all you do is keep accumulating capital, if all you do is keep building factories, that runs out of steam. And the reason that runs out of steam is that factories require maintenance. And the more factories you build, the more work you put into maintaining those factories, and the less you have left over to actually produce more stuff. So you can get some additional growth out of having more factories, more, again, I'm not sure exactly what all your majors are and how much of the economic jargon, you know, factories are among the things we call capital, physical stuff that, you know, machines, factories, and so on. You can get some more growth out of that, but that runs out of steam unless you get more ideas. The one thing that determines wages in the long run without a doubt, is the productivity of workers. More productive workers get paid more. Workers get paid essentially what they produce. And in order for workers to produce more, they have to be working with better technology, or to some extent with better equipment. But as I said, that runs out of steam. And so what we see in those wage rate increases is a measure of what we're getting out of those, the value of those ideas. Yes?
But in the real world, if you increase productivity substantially, and to the degree that that productivity is now in some sense done without even the people that are inventing the things, that are creating the things, are, you know, accumulating great benefits for that, and yet you have a certain percentage of the population now that becomes bereft of something to do, let's say. I don't know how to figure that all through, but isn't there some caution, if you will?
That's true, and it's obviously very topical right now. But it is also true, I think if you look back in history, there have been plenty of times like that before also. At the time of the Industrial Revolution, you had workers who were not schooled in the new techniques, and they were very much hurt by those new techniques. That's why you had Luddites going out and destroying the new technology. But I don't think anybody looks back and says, gee, I wish that we had not had that period in history. I wish those inventions had not happened. You know, the classic example is Thomas Edison invents the light bulb and puts all the candle makers out of work. That was really bad for the candle makers, but I don't think anybody looks back and says, gee, what a shame he invented the light bulb. These periods of transition are going to be painful for some people. But it also seems to me that in all of, and we're going through one of those now, there's no doubt of it. I mean, as the robots come in and so on, and there are a generation of people who are not schooled in how to work with robots, and those people are suffering. I don't think, if you look back at history, I don't think there are many cases where you would say, I wish we could have slowed this stuff down.
But it's not impossible then.
But it's not impossible.
Sooner or later.
It's not impossible, and it's also not impossible that this creates, you know, this creates the likelihood of more thievery or more war or more civil unrest, and that you might want to worry about that. I mean, I certainly agree with that, and I think we're seeing symptoms of it. Yeah.
Hi. So you spoke a lot on the social cost of like thievery and war and increased population. I was wondering if you could speak a bit on social cost per se of major pollution or the loss of biological species and factoring into this cost benefit analysis.
Yeah, major pollution. Again, I don't have numbers, and I if this were a research project, I'd be gathering numbers on this stuff. The point of this talk was not to draw a conclusion. It was to give a way of thinking. And I stand by the way of thinking, but I do not claim to have settled the issue because I don't have numbers on this stuff. Certainly one of the places you would want to start if you were going to turn this into a PhD thesis is start looking into the real costs of that major pollution. Biological species, I'm a little more skeptical about that. There are all kinds of biological species that I would really like to see go extinct, starting with the HIV virus. Extinction happens all the time and has been happening since long before there were people. I am not quick to say that if there's, you know, some monkey in the African jungle that's really cute that nobody knew about and it goes extinct, I'm not inclined to say we're all that much worse off as a result. I like looking at cute monkeys on the internet, but there's other stuff to look at too. Some of those other species we really, really need, and some of them we don't. And I think it is a mistake to talk about the costs of species extinction without specifying exactly what species you're talking about.
Just an increased rate.
Yeah, I mean, there may be an increased rate. It's also true that the course of evolution is that the faster species go extinct, the faster other species arise to take their place. So it's not even clear that you're in what direction you are affecting the number of species.
Okay.
Did you have a question also?
Yeah, so, and this might just be that you're not trying to draw a conclusion, but it seemed to me that the idea of there being the overpopulation problem, which gets a lot of attention from a lot of people, it seems to me that your argument is that that's mostly psychological perspective, and that because that it's not actually a problem, and that this is just the perspective of these people living in crowded areas. Am I getting that wrong, or?
It's not the way I would have worded it. I would have said that the problem is a failure to think specifically in this way, a failure to think about benefits and costs, and specifically a failure to focus on the spillover benefits and costs, a failure to realize that if I consume a bunch of fish, that doesn't count as a relevant cost unless you can show that I was taking those fish from somebody that did not have a role in the decision to bring me into the world in the first place. Why do people fail to think that way? Whether we can put that on psychology or on lack of education or on not going to enough talks like this, I don't know. I don't want to pin that on any one particular thing. I do want to argue this is the right way to think. I do observe that a lot of people don't think this way. I speculate that maybe there's some interesting psychology going on there, but I don't really know. Yeah.
Final question.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
You'll be next.
Oh, no, I was going to say this is...
Oh, all right. It does not need to be the final question as far as I'm concerned. Oh, yeah, maybe you only have the room a certain amount of times.
Just speaking of the resource consumption thing that you were talking about, using fish as an example, let's say, if the fish, like, let's say, if this salmon, maybe that's not the best example because they're pretty common, but if a certain species of fish were to go extinct, because fish are one of those species that we understand are more likely to go extinct, let's say, that's something that's very easy to farm and domesticate, wouldn't that create a certain cost that would be a spillover cost? It seemed to me just like...
But let's also consider the spillover benefit of we're bringing more people in the world who might be figuring out how to prevent those fish from going extinct. And you bring another person into the world, I don't know whether that makes it more or less likely that a species of fish will go extinct. He is more likely to take the last fish. He's also more likely to figure out how to save them.
And before you guys go, just remember the Coke forms that were on your seat. We'd really appreciate if you could fill those out from Coke Foundation. Thanks for coming, guys.